Welcome to the Happy Lawyer Project. I'm your host, Akoma Moronu, and I created this show to help lawyers find happiness in life with a law degree. Together with my guest, we provide the knowledge, skills, insight, inspiration, and encouragement you need to find your happy. To all of my fellow Americans, I cannot believe it is already July, and I just want to wish everybody a really happy and safe Independence Day. I hope you guys really enjoyed last week's episode, which happened to feature Anjali Nowakowski, who happens to be a location-independent lawyer who's building a practice around her travel dreams. So this week, I'm actually sharing a conversation with Drew Amoroso. He's the founder of Move Associates. Now, I don't know about you, but when I started practicing law, I felt like I didn't really have the practical skills that I needed to succeed. And then once I picked up the substance of practicing law, I still felt like I didn't really understand the business of being a lawyer. Other than billable hours, I had no key performance indicators or metrics for measuring my professional development. So Drew, he's a visiting lecturer and the founder of Move Associates, and he has a passion for training associates and all those crucial skills that they didn't teach us in law school. Whether you're interested in learning more about Drew's work or interested in transitioning into legal education, Drew has an inspirational outlook that I know you'll enjoy. Welcome back to the Happy Lawyer Project, lawyers. Today, I am super excited to introduce you to my newest guest, Drew Amoroso. Drew, welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
So, Drew, I would love if you could just start by sharing a brief description of who you are and what it is that you do.
Sure. So, I have a legal learning startup called Move Associates, where we work with lawyers to achieve their performance goals, accelerate their growth and development, stay professionally fulfilled, and basically help them take control of their practice and their career. So, we want to really fundamentally change education and learning in the legal industry by making learning and professional development accessible and practical and engaging.
That's really exciting. And I know a lot of lawyers out there do go into the profession feeling like they weren't properly trained for the practice of law. But before we dive into all of that, I think people would be interested in understanding your background. So why don't we start with why you became a lawyer?
Yeah, sure. So I grew up in rural Pennsylvania, so kind of small town in the middle of nowhere. And I went to a local university there, and I was inspired by an attorney that lived in the city where my college was. And he was kind of a pillar of the community there, did a lot for the community and kind of took me under his wing. And that was sort of my initial introduction to the practice of law and what lawyers do. And then from there, I decided I wanted to go to law school. I went to UC Davis in 2007 and spent a good 3 years there, and then moved to San Francisco in 2011 and got a job in BigLaw, my first job out of law school. Really enjoyed it. Actually, it was a great experience. Had phenomenal advisors and supervisors and people around me. And that was kind of how I started my career. And then I decided that I wanted to do something different, and I had my own firm for a while and did that for about a year and a half. And then after that, founded this new company about a year ago.
You said a couple things in there that I think people would be interested in understanding a little bit better. Like you, I also enjoyed my time in Big Law, but what do you think allowed you to enjoy it so much? Do you think that you were just well suited for it, or was it the culture of the firm itself or the work you got to do? Were there specific factors that you think made it more enjoyable for you?
Yeah, it was a couple of things. Number one, the people. So the firm was a firm called Reed Smith. They're an international firm. And the community of people that they had, especially in the San Francisco office, was incredible. They really were focused on empowering their young lawyers. So they gave us the opportunity to work on big cases and work on cases that we wanted to work on. So that was a really refreshing approach, I think. You know, a lot of people talk about big law environments, and you don't necessarily hear that, you know, younger associates have the ability to kind of take control of their practice that way, but that's exactly what they let us do. So that was a really good way to start my career. And then also, you know, they let me explore a little bit too. So while I was there, I started a practice that was specific to representing fitness and health and wellness and supplement and food companies. And I started to call it fitness law. So it was basically like startup law for emerging fitness brands. So I came to them with an idea and said, hey, I have this idea. It's an emerging space. No one's really talking to these fitness companies. They need help. Can we start to work with them? And they said, yeah, sure. So they gave me some, you know, professional development money to go out to conferences and to start to work with these emerging startups. And it was a really awesome experience. I learned so much from, you know, going out and bringing in business, but also having like a business plan and a marketing plan. And they gave me the platform and the runway to do that, which was really unique.
That's really amazing. And what a great opportunity. And I think also it speaks a lot to your own strengths that you were able to capitalize on that, because I don't think that everybody necessarily would have known what they wanted to do that early in their career. I think a lot of people are kind of on the conveyor belt and just let people kind of decide where to place them within the firm, and they just do the work that's given to them. And it takes them a really long time to develop their own interests within the law.
Yeah, I think that's one of the fundamental things that I see when I work with young attorneys is instead of kind of taking control of their future, they sort of let things happen to them. And of course, when you enter the profession, right, you don't 100% know what to expect. You don't really know how it works, but you are able to do certain things that help to accelerate your ability to uncover the answers to a lot of the questions that you might have. And I also know that a lot of big firms, they want leaders, right? They want people who say, I have an interest in this. I've seen a niche area where I think we can expand. In my experience, if you go to a supervisor or a managing partner and say, hey, like, I have this business plan. I have this idea. You know, what do you think about it? Can you give me a little bit of runway to explore? I think lawyers in leadership positions are more receptive to that than people think. But I think that the first and most important thing is to just kind of take control of your career and think about what it is that you want on a really consistent basis.
So if you had such a wonderful opportunity and it seemed like you were in such a great place to start your career, what led you to ultimately decide to leave?
I had a group of clients that were awesome, right? They were emerging fitness companies who were doing really cool stuff. And for me, I decided that in order to really grow that practice at the pace and at the speed that I wanted to, I had to take it out and do it on my own, separate from the firm. And again, to their credit, they were fantastic in giving me the opportunity to start it there. They were very supportive of my desire to, you know, to leave and to start my own firm. And it turns out that we were able to sort of refer work back and forth to one another. So it ended up being like a really great relationship even after I decided to take those clients with me. So yeah, I just decided that I had a vision for it, and I wanted to have a brand, and I had this sort of identity that I wanted the firm to have. And I wasn't really able to accomplish those things within the firm. And I also wanted to run my own business too. I was really interested at that point in having my own business. And so it was kind of a few things coming together at the same time.
So then you went to solo practice, but then ultimately ended up transitioning into this training space. How did that come about?
Yeah. So I really enjoyed working with my clients, and, you know, it was being able to support what they were doing and their businesses. It was fantastic. I really enjoyed what they were doing. I mean, their mission for the most part was to help other people live healthier, better lives. And so that was something I could really get behind. But it got to a point where I was looking at, you know, my future and thinking about what it was that I wanted to do. And, you know, my goals in terms of my growth as an individual and as a professional weren't really aligned with practicing law anymore, which was fine. And so I had this nagging feeling for a really long time that I wanted to work with other attorneys, like to train other attorneys and to mentor them. So I had spent a lot of time around lawyers and kind of kept hearing the same things and seeing the same patterns and how many of them described their work. You know, they felt underprepared, overwhelmed, and a little bit unempowered and didn't really know how to take control of their career. A lot of my friends were leaving firms. They were leaving the practice of law altogether. And when I look closely at that, I felt from a fundamental level that we weren't really doing enough to develop and prepare lawyers for success. So we weren't giving them a platform they can use to set and achieve their goals. So like consistent focus training and regular evaluation and feedback, sometimes that's not really built into our professional culture. But if you look at all the statistics and the feedback that you get from attorneys who do receive that kind of training and have the opportunity to learn in that way, this is the kind of thing that people want from their profession, especially the millennial generation. So the legal profession is rooted in history and tradition, and the tradition has been a little bit of a sink or swim model. And the billable hour sometimes discourages, this regular mentoring. And I saw a really great opportunity to change the narrative and to help solve some of those problems. So I had been the head of the summer program at Reed Smith for a number of years. So I got to really work closely with law students and to, onboard them into our program, evaluate them, help to train them. I set up training programs at our local bar association. So it was something I was really passionate about for a long time. And I thought, you know what, this is a really important thing that I don't think we're doing enough of. And I love to do it. And so that's when I made the decision to start this new company.
I want to touch briefly on kind of the stuff you were talking about that you did at the firm, because I also loved that stuff, all of the summer program mentoring. And I, ran the summer program for my practice group and was very involved in the recruitment and things like that. And I love working with young lawyers. And I always loved going out to law schools to talk about on panels and help with trainings and CLEs and things like that. So for those people out there who are interested in becoming more involved in things like that, but haven't really seen the opportunity of their own firm, how did it come about for you? Was it something that you sought out, or were you approached to participate?
Yeah, I definitely sought it out. It was probably, one of the most exciting times of the year, I think, for our office, because you had new people in the office for a couple of months. And it was just really a privilege to work with them and to see how much of an impact you could have on the beginning of their career. It's such an important time for 2L and 3L students who are trying to figure out what it is that they want to do, trying to learn what it takes to make the transition successfully from law school to, a practicing attorney. So I just really enjoyed those opportunities, and I definitely sought them out. And I think, again, to Reed Smith's credit, they were really excited and enthusiastic about involving all of the lawyers in their office in that kind of summer training. So it was great.
So today, through Move Associates, you offer a number of different courses for lawyers in different stages of their career, from summer associate to kind of younger junior associate, and then kind of in the early years of their career. How did you come about those courses? And, I just love if you could share a little bit more about these training programs so people can get a feel of what you think you're doing differently.
Sure. So most of the courses I really developed from my own experience as an associate in Big Law for 6 years, the training that I did informally over the years that I mentioned before, both at the firm and at law schools and at our bar association. And I attended a lot of training sessions myself too. So I was, I made it a priority to be taught and to develop my own skills throughout the years. And so I drew from all of those experiences and really crafted a series of courses that are really focused on the things that are important on a day-to-day level, but also on a longer-term, sort of broader view, right? So I don't think that we're focusing enough on the day-to-day skills or the long-term career planning at a firm or at your whatever legal position it is that you have. So things like habit building, practice management, working with others, how you work effectively with the people around you, how do you provide excellent client service, how do you build a really robust professional network where people are helping you and you're able to help other people. These are the kinds of things that I think are making up most of an associate's day, right? Like brief writing and oral argument, like those are incredibly important skills. But there's all these other skills that are really, in many instances, the secret sauce when it comes to associates who are achieving, success on a day-to-day basis. And then in terms of the long-term planning, I think we have to have a steady diet of consistent training that is driven by goals. So, in the business world, most evaluations and most business-driven goals are done on a quarterly basis. And, as a profession, like we generally do a review once a year in most instances or many instances. But I feel like in order to make the kind of incremental progress and to stay focused on the importance of developing professionally, there has to be more of an emphasis on these like shorter term goals, which in turn lead to like the longer term development that we're all focused on. You know, unfortunately, the practice of law is so intense on a day-to-day basis that there's not much time to think about, okay, well, what do I even want from this, right? Or just really focused on, okay, what do I have to do today? And what's coming up tomorrow? You know, I'm exhausted. I'm going to go home and call it a day. So I think learning the skills that will allow you to build those kinds of practices into the work that you do allows you to think more clearly about what it is that you want. And again, like you can incrementally make progress toward your goal. So that's kind of some of the substance, but also some of the methodology that I think is really key to the programs that we teach. So, you know, the 1 hour CLEs are great, but in order to really make change, you have to be consistent and you have to look at progress on a daily and a weekly and monthly basis.
I love that you're talking about goal setting, because now that I've gone in-house, there's so much more of a focus on tracking goals and really pinning your progress and your bonus to have the accomplishment of those goals and right. How those goals kind of move the entire business forward. And I have to admit, the first time I was asked to create these goals, I literally had no idea where to start. And I think sometimes when you're in a firm, you almost let billables become the substitute for substantive goals.
Right.
And they're easy, they're measurable, and you don't even have to think about them because someone else creates the goal for you.
Right.
But as you know, and I know, we all know, there are good billables and there are bad billables. There are people who hit their hours who learn a lot. There are people who hit their hours who don't learn much. There are people who don't hit their hours who actually are learning quite a bit. And it really just depends on how you see your time at the firm and how focused you are on gaining substantive skills. So for those lawyers out there who've never really thought about setting, you know, substantive skills-based goals, which is what I assume is what you're referencing, but maybe correct me if I'm wrong, what kind of tips would you give them about goal setting for your career?
Yeah, it's a great question. And there's been so much that's been written on this. And, you know, there are podcasts and books and article after article on goal setting and how to do this. And so it can be, you know, on the one hand, we may not know how to do it. On the other hand, it can be a little bit intimidating, right? Because it seems like, well, how do I even start that process? Like, I'm not even sure what I want. So in our course and in the courses that I teach in law school too, we spend the first part of the course just talking about the why part. And that's the most important part. That's where you have to start. Like, why? What is it that I want? Why am I doing this? You know, before you ever start to take any action and to actually think about your goals, you have to kind of back it up a step and say, why? You know, what motivates me? What do I want? Do I want to make a lot of money? Do I want to help a certain kind of person? You know, do I enjoy, you know, intellectual stimulation? What is it that is really driving me every day? And if you can tap into that and get clear on that, then that will allow you to position yourself to kind of think more strategically and with a little bit clearer vision in terms of what it is that you want. So I think starting with the why part and then looking at 6 month, 1 month, and 18 month goals, just in a general sense, like at the end of the year, if I was going to write my review for this year, what would I say about myself, right? What would I, ideally, what would I accomplish? Right? Or 18 months from now, where do I want to be in 18 months? Do I want to be promoted? Do I want to have worked on a certain type of case? Do I want to have brought in, you know, started to bring in my own book of business? What is it that you want? And so that's, I think there's a couple components. There's like the longer term part of it, which I think is very important to think about and to write down. And then there's the quarterly part too. So yes, a yearly billable hour goal is what many people have, but the problem with that, or the challenge, is that you can kind of cruise for a while, you know, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, and you're not really accountable for your progress in that time frame, right? So what ends up happening is your schedule becomes all out of whack. And if you focus though on things like the quarterly goal, so what am I going to achieve these over the next 12 weeks that's going to drive me closer toward some of those longer goals that I want. That's, I think, really is helpful because it will hold you accountable. You have a clear vision and you can accomplish a lot in 12 weeks and you're more motivated. So if I say, this is what I'm accomplishing in 90 days, then I have a much clearer path to doing that than if I say, this is what I want to do by the end of the year. So that's the thing. The other thing I would mention too is having people hold you accountable, right? In the law firm setting, you know, everyone is so busy. The billable hour is really driving people to bill more. So if you want to set goals, you have to figure out who is going to help keep you accountable, whether that's an accountability partner, a supervisor, you know, someone at the firm, but having some help to really force you to follow the outline that you've set for yourself, I think is also really important too.
You mentioned briefly that you are also teaching. So I want to transition a little to that work that you do as a visiting lecturer, because I know that that's often things when lawyers think about other things they can do with their degree, I think teaching comes up for a lot of them. How did you go about getting that role? Why did you decide that was a good addition to all the other stuff that you were working on?
Yeah. So first I'll say that teaching has been by far the most rewarding experience, professional experience I've ever had, like hands down. Being in the classroom and being able to teach, and like I said before, just even contribute in a small way to someone figuring out what it is that they want to do, incredibly rewarding. So for me, I had always wanted to do it. I had had some ideas about different courses. I didn't want to teach a practice area. Like I didn't want to teach IP law. I didn't want to teach, you know, business associations or anything like that. I wanted to teach something practical. And so right around the time when I was kind of kicking this idea around, it would have been the middle of 2016, I happened to run into Kevin Johnson, who is the dean of UC Davis School of Law. He's a really great dean and it's my alma mater. And I met him at a networking event and he said, "What are you up to? How's your new firm going?" And I said, "Well, I actually decided I wanted to do something different." And he said, "Oh, okay, tell me about it." And at the time I had kind of formulated the idea, but was still working it through. But in a nutshell, I knew I wanted to help lawyers on a big scale. And he said, "Well, that's great. Like anything I can do to help you, just let me know." And I said, "Actually, now that you mention it, I would love to teach a course. I have this idea. I'd like to call it something like a practice ready seminar. And I want to teach law students how they can help themselves get ready to practice. So basically empower them with the skills and the tools and the confidence to go out and, you know, help them start to shape their career, which I think they should be doing in law school." And he said, "That sounds like a great idea." So I followed up with him the next day. And, you know, within a couple of days, I had given them a draft syllabus and they approved it. And again, to their credit, you know, they took a chance on me and I taught my first full semester last fall at Davis. I taught the same course at Golden Gate University in the spring, and I'm going to be teaching at the University of San Francisco in the fall. So, and going back to Davis too, actually. So I'm going to teach two courses in the fall. But yeah, I think for anyone who has a desire to teach, I would say go after it, you know, come with your idea and have it fleshed out. And I think that there are lots of opportunities for people with great ideas who are passionate about helping law students. I think that that's a winning combination. And I'm really fortunate that they said yes, because like I said, it's been an incredible experience to be able to teach.
How serendipitous that worked out for you. How much time does teaching actually take?
So the course that I teach is a two unit seminar. So it's 2 hours of class time. And I think the ABA standards are that you have to have 6 hours or 3 hours of homework for each credit of in-class time. So basically like 6 hours of homework that you have to prepare. So my first semester I was definitely spending a lot of time, you know, creating what I wanted to be interesting content, you know, so slides and visuals, and I wanted to have resources that were both grounded in the legal profession, but also from the business world and from psychology and all these other factors, you know, communications, efficiency, right? Like management principles. And I wanted to kind of meld all of those things into the course, because that's really what I think students should be learning. And a lot of professional development and building professional networks, I think that's incredibly important too. So the first time I created the content, it took me a while. So I would say probably at least, you know, 4 to 5 hours a week each semester, or sorry, each week for the first semester, I was spending just creating the content and then going to class. But now I kind of have the nuts and bolts there. And so it was definitely a time commitment, but well worth the investment.
When you first started down that path, did you at any point feel like you weren't qualified to do what you wanted to do?
So no, except it's interesting being on the other side, looking out at a classroom. So for you or anyone else who has ever done that before, you kind of get these like blank stares back at you sometimes, right? So I remember very clearly the first week I was so excited to go in there and talk, and I, you know, was kind of poor, you know, telling them like, this is going to be, I'm going to make this, I want this to be about you and what you need, and it's all about you, and I want to help you, and my goal is to set you up for success. And I remember just seeing like they were just looking at me like, and I was thinking in my head, you know, anybody give me like a sign, like a head nod, like give me something that is, you know, going to confirm that, you know, this is that you think that this will be helpful for you. So that, and I did eventually get, you know, a lot of really great feedback. And I think the students who have taken the course have, you know, they said to me that they really enjoyed it and that they benefit a lot from it. But I actually didn't feel unqualified because the things that I was talking about were, I believe in wholeheartedly. I literally was getting up every day thinking about these things and how to help them. And as I said before, empower them to take control of their career. So, and I had done something very similar with my career. And so being able to tell my story and to infuse like real world experience with the material was not, I felt like exceptionally well qualified to do that because it was just, it was inside me and I wanted to let them know. So I know that I would have not felt qualified to go in and to tell them about contracts or torts or anything like that, because that's, you know, that's not something that I'm passionate about. So I definitely would have felt at a disadvantage if that's what I was teaching. But with this material, I was able to get up every day and really speak to them from the heart about what I thought was important and why it was important.
I absolutely love that your answer was no, because I think sometimes as lawyers, we can become very focused on credentials.
Yeah.
And often people want to do these things and they think they need to go back to school and they need to get some validation in order to take that step. And for you, it was really the thought you had put into it and the lived experience that you were willing to share with your students that qualified you for the job.
Yeah, I think two things. Like number one, material is material, right? I mean, they could read everything that I told them in a book. We didn't use a book. We use all kinds of different things. But it's not really about the material, especially with this topic. It's more about the discussion. It's more about the storytelling. It's more about identifying what it is that motivates them and what they're afraid of and, you know, what it is that they're thinking about sitting in that chair before they're about to enter, you know, profession. And sort of to your point, I think you're absolutely right. Lawyers, we are really good at trying to be perfect all the time, all day long, right? And having this, you know, very pristine kind of exterior and, you know, make sure that we italicize this period and underline, you know, this part, right? Because if we don't do that, you know, the blue book tells us we're supposed to do that. And that's great for a legal brief. But when it comes to something like teaching, if you get caught up in the perfection mindset and even developing, you know, your career, you'll move too slow and opportunities will pass you by. So I think you're absolutely right. You don't need a PhD behind your name to go in and teach. You don't have to have gone to, you know, the best schools or the highest ranked schools in order to do it. You actually, if it's something you want to do, you absolutely can do it.
So for my listeners out there who are still in law school, and I know there are a few of them because I hear from them quite a bit, what advice would you give them about making the most of their time in law school? Because I know there's certainly a lot of things I would have done differently, but
yeah.
You talk to law students more often than I do these days. So
yeah, I think the number one thing I would say is that you have to take control of your future and your career. You have the ability to shape your career more than you know. So it's important to be immersed in school and to, you know, go to class and learn concepts and theory. And that's really important. But you also have to be equally focused on learning what it's like to practice law and be a lawyer. It's really hard to replicate that in a school setting. So you have to get out of the school setting. And I mean that sincerely, like go outside the school, go talk to lawyers and help yourself by learning from people who are already doing it. So one example is I in my first class at Davis, you know, there was a woman who really wanted to be a family law attorney. I said, okay, well, have you talked to any family law attorneys? And she said, no, she never had. So one of our assignments was for everyone in the class to go out and network or contact three practicing attorneys and schedule some kind of a coffee or a phone call with them to learn about what it was that they do. So yeah, it's great to learn about family law, but if you're interested in family law, go talk to some family law attorneys, like go an alum from your school, right? It's uncomfortable. It takes work, but this is your career. Like what, you know, it's in your hands, you know, you do everything that you can to learn as much about it and figure out quickly, you know, what it is that you want to do. You know, one other thing I'll say is in our class, we talk about why it's so hard as a law student to network with practicing attorneys. And usually it comes down to the fact that number one, it can feel kind of awkward. Number two, most law students don't feel like they have anything to add to the conversation with practicing lawyers. And then number three, if they reach out and ask for coffee or hear more about someone's practice, they think that if they do that, they're going to be bothering someone, right? Like a lawyer is just too busy to actually talk to me, so I'm not going to even bother them. And if I get rejected, well, you know, that's the end of the world. But the truth is that you don't need to magically come up with something novel to talk about. You just talk and you're yourself. And more importantly, you ask questions. Lawyers love to tell law students about their path and what it took for them to get to where they are. So it's just a conversation. It's not a quiz. You don't have to blow someone's socks off with your legal theories, right? You just have to start. And people do have time for you. And a soft place to start is with alumni who you can call up or email and say, hey, I'm going to UC Davis. I saw that you practice family law. I'd love to hear more about how you got to where you are, your career trajectory. Things like that are incredibly important. So I think if we're talking about how to make the most of their time, go out and learn about the profession, talk to people who are doing it, and don't be afraid of getting a little bit uncomfortable and going outside of your comfort zone.
That's really great advice. And I'm embarrassed at how few lawyers I actually spoke to before becoming a lawyer. The answer is zero.
Yeah.
And I will also go out on a limb and say, please don't try to impress anybody with your legal knowledge during these informational kind of conversations. I think you should really go in with an open mind and to listen.
Yeah.
No one expects you to know everything. I think I would add one final thing, that another great place to start may be podcasts, because I think a lot of people come on podcasts who have already expressed an interest in sharing their story and are very open to connecting. And usually at the end of the podcast, they offer information about how to reach out. And in my experience, those people are very open to having a conversation. So that might be another path for people who feel nervous about reaching out kind of cold. I think that it's almost as if you're just responding to an open invitation to reach out.
Yeah, absolutely. I totally agree with that. I mean, and I'll confide to you and all of your listeners that I only spoke to a handful of attorneys too. And that's, I'm not really sure why I did that, but it should be the opposite. You should be talking to a lot of attorneys. And yeah, resources like podcasts are a great way to just hear stories, because the more stories you hear and the path that people take to get to where they are, it makes the process look more attainable and sort of humanize people in a different way. And yes, don't try to impress anyone with any of your, you know, your legal scholarship, because you don't really have any.
Yeah. That is blunt but true. So
Yeah.
For those new lawyers who kind of missed that chance to have those conversations before they started practicing, are there any tips you have for them or resources that you would suggest for new lawyers, young or old, who are trying to figure their way through the profession?
No, I think my number one suggestion would be, you know, the best resource for attorneys are the networks that they have around them. So even people who are one or two steps ahead of you. So if you're a 2L, like having a 3L to talk to, or if you're a 3L, having a first year to talk to, just to kind of get a sense of what it is that it took to get there. And again, hearing the stories of other people can really empower you and give you ideas about how to go about the next step. So I think having as many conversations with people who are in your network and just starting to build a network piece by piece, that's my number one piece of advice for attorneys who are looking for ways to transition into the practice. There are some, you know, books and other things out there too, but there's no real substitute for hearing it right from people who have just done it.
That's great advice. And for lawyers who can be, again, overly intellectual and overly in their heads, getting out there and having real conversations and meeting real people and hearing the real stories is always going to be important, because at the end of the day, you can't ever kind of in your mind on your own answer these types of questions.
Yeah, we can kind of get caught up, I think, or just easy to get caught up in like this theoretical, you know, like conversation about this or that, which again is good for, you know, theorizing about the law. But yeah, you can't substitute just having conversations with people. And if you're nervous about networking, the best way to get over that is to just go out and do it.
Before we go, I want to transition briefly to kind of your own habits, mindset, and the things that drive your success, because it seems like you have this confidence and this clarity of vision about your life. How do you go about making decisions about which projects or opportunities to pursue?
Yeah. So, I mean, I spend a lot of time thinking about projects and opportunities, because to me, there's the things that I'm interested in are broad ranging, right? So, and you only have so much time in the day. And I really want to be focused on the things that are the most impactful. So I spend at least one full day a quarter and a half day each month working strictly on planning. So I don't look at email. I shut down everything else. I'm not working on anything else except for long-term planning and like idea generation and thinking about, like thinking really critically about the stuff that I want to do. So it's just a full day blocked off on my calendar. But then once I make a decision, I really try to act quickly, because I found that too much planning and analyzing can be really paralyzing. And the faster I do something and the quicker I figure out if it's a good idea or not, that's helpful for me. And you hear that advice a lot, right? Like fail fast, right? So you can figure out what works. That's a pretty standard piece of advice. A lot of times from, you know, the business will often give that advice. So I spend a lot of time planning, and it's blocked off on my calendar, and it's, I don't talk to anyone for a full day. And then once I figure that out, I get to work. On a daily basis, I'm laser focused on identifying one big thing I need to do each day that will move my business forward. So if I can get the one big thing done each day, then all the other little things usually fall into place. But if I let the minutiae kind of run my day, then I find that I just get bogged down in all these little things that at the end of the day don't really matter that much. And these are all things that we talk about in my course, and that we teach at in my law school course too. Just how do you manage your priorities and figure out what's the most important thing to do? So those are some of the big things that I do on a, you know, on a day-to-day and monthly basis to make sure that I'm planning and doing the stuff that's the most impactful.
I am so intrigued by this one day thing. My husband and I do a quarterly, what we call couples retreat, and we go for a weekend. And so we each take kind of a day to do our own thing. And then we spend a whole day kind of aligning our visions.
Yeah.
And I think that that's helped a lot, especially with the kids and with so many schedules, just making sure that we're both headed in the same direction has become really important. And it's just nice. We always go away somewhere to like a spa and, you know, do it right. But I'm interested in knowing if you could share a little bit about the format of your day. Is it very structured, or do you just kind of create a lot of time to just think and journal? Like, what, how do you come spend that day?
Yeah. So I do like to have structured days. It's probably part of the reason why I liked practicing law, the structure of it. So my morning routine is, I have a morning routine that I follow pretty much every morning. So I kind of go through the same four or five things every morning, which gets me in a rhythm for the day. And this is before I don't crack open email first thing. I don't do anything business related. I try to get myself in order before I start to, you know, interact with other people in my business. So I'll do things like, I'm a really big fan of meditation. So just a couple of minutes of meditation, like 5 or 10 a day. And we actually meditated in my class, in the law school class. And the first week, every time I do this, the first week, there's like some like, oh, okay. And then every week we just get into this rhythm, and it's amazing how much the students who have gone through the course really enjoy that part. But anyway, I do some meditation each day. I'm a huge coffee drinker, so I'm down in the big thing of coffee. I do a couple of minutes of light movement just to kind of wake my body up. I'll journal for a couple of minutes. And then I do this thing where I write out like two notes to people. So like two thank you notes, or if it was someone I met the day before, or someone in, you know, in my professional circle that I was thinking about, I'll just write them like a thinking of you note, right? And that kind of gets me focused on other people, right? And thinking about just like staying in touch with people. So that's kind of my personal way that I enter the day. And then I have this thing I call an open up and a shutdown checklist that I use when I start my business day. So I go through the same three or four things each day to open up, like a morning routine. And then I have seven things that I do at the end of the day to shut it down. So like things that I would start with are picking out the one thing that I mentioned that's really important. Like, what's the one big thing I need to do today? Looking at my calendar, planning out blocks of uninterrupted time throughout the day, and just getting my schedule straight. So I start the day with planning. And then once I've got all my planning done, I go after it as hard as I can. And then when I'm done, like, I really like to be done at the end of the day, because I find if I overextend myself, I'm no good the next day. So I might as well, you know, close it down and be done. So I have there's a lot of planning in my day. My weekends, I let myself, you know, do whatever I want, but usually Monday through Friday, I'm pretty regimented with how I approach the day.
How did you come up with these schedules? I mean, your morning schedule sounds like a modified Miracle Morning, but did you develop these over time, or is this something you learned from somebody or that you read somewhere? Because it does seem like some of it comes from stuff I've heard before, but obviously they're not like novel ideas. So I'm interested in knowing, how'd you come up with them?
Yeah, they're definitely not novel ideas. I pulled them from a lot of the fitness entrepreneurs that I mentioned before. Like, they are so in tune with habits and wellness and just, you know, hacking how to approach your day, you know, starting your day focused on getting yourself in the right mindset and your own wellness, so that you can go off and help other people, right? Because you're not really able to help other people, your family, your clients, your coworkers, unless you are well yourself. So it's almost like that, the idea of like when you're on a plane, right? And they tell you, like, if the mask drops from the ceiling, like, put it on like a small child first, right? And then put on yourself first before you put it on a small child, because you can't help anybody else unless you are taking care of yourself. So it's that same kind of mindset, but that's where I pulled it from. And just like things I've heard over the years, and really people who are experts and much, much smarter than me and when it comes to these things. And I just crafted a routine that worked for me. So a little bit of trial and error, but yeah, I'm going through that. I feel like that just ticks all the things I need. So mindset and, you know, movement, and then kind of waking up my brain. Yeah. So lots of different things I've pulled from over the years.
I love that. And that makes perfect sense. And I really appreciate you sharing all that. I love talking about habits and mindset and structuring your day, because I think that these aren't things we learn. Like, we don't learn how to like live our life. We learn a lot of substance, but no one teaches us how to like just manage life.
Yeah. And especially attorneys, right? That's definitely not something that you learn in law school or on the job. So I think it's incredibly important for attorneys, because the level of stress and the amount of responsibility that we have, it's so important to think about how you're going to approach your life and your day so that you can be at your best. So really important stuff for lawyers.
So what is the best way for people to follow you and learn more about what you're up to at Move Associates? Because I know that people are going to be interested in connecting.
Yeah, sure. Well, I'd love to connect on LinkedIn. I feel like that's one of the best ways to just connect one-to-one. And I'd love to talk with anyone who's listening, who wants to talk further about any of the stuff that we covered today. My website is move-associates, so move-associates.com, or I'm on Instagram too. I like Instagram a lot, at move.associates, and would really enjoy talking with anybody who's interested in any of the topics that we covered today.
Fantastic. And I will include links to all of that on the show notes at thehappylawyerproject.com. So for those of you who are on the subway or out on a run, you can find that information there. Thank you so much, Drew, for being a part of this project and for sharing your story with my audience today. I mean, there's so much that you've shared that I think is going to really impact people's lives and allow them to take action. But before I let you go, I have one last question, and that is, what do you think separates happy lawyers from those lawyers who struggle to find happiness in life with a law degree?
I think the number one thing is understanding your why. So what it is that motivates you, what you want from your life, who you want to help, you know, asking those sorts of questions. They're not easy questions to answer, and sometimes you won't have the answer right in front of you, but the point is to just keep asking the question. That's what you have to do. And I think the people who continually ask the question are the ones who are the happiest.
Awesome. Thank you, Drew.
Thanks so much for listening this week, you guys, and joining me for the Happy Lawyer Project podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please feel free to share it with your friends. And I'd love for you to head over to iTunes and leave a rating and review. I want to say a huge thank you to everyone who's already left a review, sent me an email, DM'd me on Instagram, or reached out to me in any other way. I truly appreciate you and love hearing from you. And I want to just remind everyone that this week's sponsor is Common Bond. So if you're considering refinancing your student loans this year, I would definitely head over to commonbond.co/happylawyer to check them out. As a reminder, you'll receive a $200 cash bonus for using that link. Until next week, I hope everyone finds their happy.